Well, I know that God's got some things in store for us, and I know that God wants to speak to us through His Word tonight. So let's, without any further ado, let's just get into God's Word, huh? Let's go before the Lord and let's pray. Would you just join with me and let's just bow our heads and prepare to hear from God. God, we thank You for tonight. Lord, we thank You for Your house. We thank You for the ability that we have to come into this place. Lord, we don't come for a social club or for tradition. But Lord, we just come into this place to hear from You. And we ask that Your Word would be alive to us, would be real to us. Father, I pray that what You've impressed upon me, God, that You would impress upon each and every one of us, Lord, that You would speak to us individually right where we're at, Your will, Your desires for us tonight. We pray that You would help us to open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, Lord, Your will, Your desire for us, that we walk out of here equipped and encouraged to be, to do what and who You've called us to be. So, Lord, we thank You for this house. We thank You for the blessings that You've given to each and every one of us in this place. And Lord, we ask that You bless all the churches across the Inland Empire tonight, throughout the course of this week, that are meeting, that are hearing and preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Bless them as You've blessed us, and we give You that praise in Jesus' mighty name. We all together said,
Amen.
Amen. If you got your Bibles, go with me to Luke in the second chapter, Luke chapter 2. I was real proud of myself this year. Over the course of the past couple of years, you know, I've been kind of a Grinchy Christmas person. You know what I'm talking about? When it's you know, can I get any self-professed Christmas Grinches? It's all right. Don't be ashamed. Look, there's more of y'all than I thought there would be. And that's probably only half of you, because the rest of you are like, I'm not even admitting that. But I remember, you know, when it came to the Christmas season, it was always such a hassle to set up a Christmas tree and to get on a ladder and put lights out and stuff like that. And there was just different things that I was just opposed to. I just was never really into that. And I remember a couple of years ago, we were talking, Stacy and I, we were talking about, like, hey man, you know, trying to change that mentality with us. And so, you know, I went to the Home Depot or to the home store, I don't know what store it was, with my kids, and Bjorn was 3 at the time, Emma was like 1.5 or 18 months old, and we kind of went and we went through and just said, all right, you guys pick out whatever you want for the house and we'll just put it up. And I was always the kind of person that, like, if I put up Christmas lights, they needed to be exactly, like, in line and proportionate. I didn't want to have, like, extra lights hanging over, and there had to be, like, a staple for every light so that they hung perfect. You know, I was that kind of person. Like, my video team and my AV team, they all know, like, there's just that OCD about me in that sense. And it was a total change of mentality, because they picked out all these ugly lights and blinking, you know, the icicles that are really messy. And they picked out, Bjorn picked out this blow-up penguin that has like a Santa hat. And somebody bought my daughter a Hello Kitty inflatable with a little mistletoe around her neck. And I told that person, it was my mother-in-law, I said, over my dead body, will that ever be displayed in my house? And they were just like, hey, you know what, Dad, we want to do this. And so we just went crazy. We just put up all these Christmas lights and all these different decorations, and it was fun. And then things started to change. And this year I was really proud of myself, because, you know, Halloween came and we had our harvest thing. Everybody was tired. And about 3 days after Halloween came, I was the first person on my block to break out all the Christmas lights. I was the first person to put them up. Everybody kind of came out, was looking at me like, you're kind of starting a little early, aren't you? You're not supposed to start decorating for Christmas until after Thanksgiving. And I'm like, no, I'm going to get in that Christmas spirit. I put the Hello Kitty proudly in my front yard. Just a proud dad, you know, a little white Hello Kitty with some mistletoe, and big old penguin with a Santa hat, and Christmas lights of all different colors. It's just a hot mess in front of my house. We brought out the Christmas tree. This year was really fun watching the kids. You know, we've always had our stuff packaged really nicely. And this year we just said, hey kids, go decorate the tree. And they took the Christmas ornaments and the bulbs. And we had to use plastic ones, because you can't use glass Christmas ornaments when you have a 5 and a 3-year-old. And it was so much fun. We were watching them, and they were taking them like baseballs, just throwing them at the tree. And anything that stuck just was it. So our tree literally is just, it's a hot mess. And but it's beautiful. And I was just really proud of myself, because it's like, you know what? I'm getting into the Christmas spirit. I'm really there. I'm leading the way, paving the path for my neighborhood. It was really cool. You know what's fun? Is Christmas can really be a special season, can it? I mean, think about it. All of a sudden, the radios, they start changing. They play the same songs over and over again. Those old-timey carols, you know, the Frank Sinatra and the Bing Crosby and all the special songs. And there's all these cool old Christmas songs. And attitudes start changing. People get a little bit happier. You see smiles. People say Merry Christmas to each other when ordinarily they wouldn't even say hello to each other. They might even go as far as to say Happy Holidays. But, you know, they say something to each other. It's really cool because, you know, the cities, they start decorating with little snowflakes and tinsel. And we even drove through one town and they put a big tinsel thing across that said Merry Christmas. And it was just like, how cool is that? And then on top of the songs and just that Christmas spirit, then there's those sweaters. You know what I'm talking about, those sweaters? They're only socially acceptable to wear them for like 2 weeks a year, that ugly Christmas sweater. Anybody have an ugly Christmas sweater that you're like super pumped to wear? I have one. It's beautiful. It's hideous. All in the same. There's Christmas sweaters. And then on top of that, how special Christmas can be, then you start adding seasonal food, right? Then there's like the Christmas food. There's like the holiday drinks and like the apple cider. And if you're in Southern California, you can't but not love tamales, right? I mean, it's like it's tamale season. It's like, oh, finally it rolls around. And then there's Christmas parties and everybody's getting together. And then there's Christmas pageants and everybody's spending their time. And then there's office parties. And then there's gift exchanges, and then there's the season of Black Friday, and Christmas can kind of get a little overwhelming, can't it? We can kind of get carried away when we get into the season of Christmas. You know, sometimes it's fun to go to a party, but in our day and age, everybody's throwing their own party, and it's like there's a Christmas party on Friday night and Saturday night and on Sunday night and on Tuesday morning and on Tuesday night and on Wednesday afternoon, and then there's a pageant for your kid, and then there's a pageant for your neighbor's kid, and then there's a pageant for your nephew, and then there's a recital, and then there's that one lady in that recital that always has to sing that song, and you're like, you don't need to sing. And it can just get a little overwhelming. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah.
And then you start to ask yourself, what is Christmas really all about? I mean, like, what is really, honestly, like really, think about it for a moment. Let's really think about this. What is Christmas really all about? Oh, well, Pastor Luke, I mean, you're baiting me with the question. Christmas is all about Jesus. Put the Christ in Christmas, and Jesus is the reason for the season, right? Anybody know what I'm talking about? But when we look at the lives that we live and we look at what we do in this holiday season and we ask ourselves this honest question, even though we know the cliche or the answer that the preacher's looking for, what is Christmas really all about? And that's what I started asking myself through the course of all the business and all the hoopla that we go through. And I asked myself this question, is what we do in the holiday spirit, whether it's good or bad, is all the different things that we do, all the money we spend putting up decorations on our house, all the money. Did you know that Christmas is an $800 billion economy? That the average American will spend $575 this year on gifts and will receive $300 in gifts in return. And when we look at all of the hoopla and all the different things that we go through for Christmas, to celebrate Christmas, I have to ask myself, is this really what God wanted for us? Is all of this really what God desired when we think of what Christmas is? And of course, Christmas is all about Jesus. And of course, Christmas is Jesus is the reason for the season. But when we look at all the different things we subject ourselves through from the end of November, it used to be that Friday after Thanksgiving, but that Friday after Thanksgiving is really about the deals now. So it's kind of like the Tuesday after Cyber Monday from that till about January 6th when the Rose Parade floats start to deteriorate, that the season starts to end, and then your neighbors start looking at you kind of weird in the middle of January because you haven't taken your stuff down yet. Through that month and a half of what we subject ourselves to, the busyness, the presents, the gift giving, the gift receiving, the food, the parties, the dressing up, the hosting, the Yuletide, the songs, the Christmas Hallmark movies, all the different things that we see. We have to ask ourselves, is this really what God wanted for us? I wanted to take you to a story in the Christmas, and the Bible really doesn't talk very much about this season. There's only two New Testament books that really account for or recount the brief story of Jesus' book. Mark picks up right off Jesus' ministry time, and John kind of gives us this obscure Christmas story in a Genesis-type way, and it's really kind of cool, but really it's Matthew and Luke that write about the story of the birth of Jesus, and in this is a few little details of what God has for us. And I thought I'd just take you to a story here of Christmas. And in Luke, the second chapter, there's some shepherds that are out in the field. And they're watching their sheep, tending to their sheep by night. And all of a sudden, as Luke recounts the story from eyewitnesses, he says that an angel appeared before the shepherd and they trembled and they were afraid. And the angel, I believe, says what God's desire for us in the Christmas season is. And the angel says in Luke, the second chapter, verse number 10, he says, the angel says to these shepherds, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. I believe that's the heart of what God wants for the Christmas season, is good tidings of great joy. A season of joy, a time of happiness, a time of reflection, a time of enjoyment, a time of thinking of. And he says, listen, there's something really big that's happening and you're going to be really happy when you know what's happening right now. And it's good tidings. The world's going to change from this moment forward because of what's going on. And so we say and we look at that verse and then I look at my life and I look at what Christmas is and I look at what the holiday seasons are and I look at, you know, Thanksgiving to Christmas to New Year's to all the different things that go on and, you know, maybe you try to throw in Advent and Hanukkah and all the different things on there on top of it. And I say, man, is this what God, am I doing living what God wanted for me to live? Is this what God's desire for was for me, for Christmas? Because ultimately we say, yeah, Jesus came, and I'm really happy about that. But then I have 10 Christmas parties to attend, and I have 5 gift exchanges to buy a gift of $10 to $25 in value, plus that white elephant gift. And then somebody gave me a fruitcake, and no matter how much I tell them, I can't stand fruitcake. And then I got 3 different recitals to go to. And on top of that, I've got to host my family, and then I go to this family, and then we go to that family, and then my kids are on vacation. So now I got to deal with kids for 2.5 weeks. When does school start again? And I don't really feel like what the angels are saying. As a matter of fact, to describe it more accurately, I feel like how I feel is a little bit more like Clark W. Griswold in Christmas Vacation. After he goes through all the process of lighting up his house and he goes and he's drum roll please and he goes to plug in his lights and the lights don't come on. That's kind of more how I feel by the time Christmas is here. But the angel said to the shepherds, I bring you good tidings of joy. But in this season, by the time it's here, by the time it's actually December 25th, I'm ready for it to be December 26th. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And so we ask ourselves, what is Christmas really all about? What is Christmas? I mean, think about it like this. What is Christmas? Is Christmas some global birthday party? Is that really what Christmas is? That it's a birthday party on a global scale throughout the course of history? Well, we know for the most part that it's probably actually not that, because we know that Jesus more than likely was not born on December 25th of 0 AD. So is it this global birthday party? Well, no, not really. I mean, think about it like this. How would you feel if somebody came to you 6 months after your birthday, it's like, I'm throwing you a birthday party today. Kind of be like, hey, it's really not my birthday. But, you know, hey, I won't say no. If you're going to give me a gift, I'll take it, right? So is Christmas this global birthday party? Well, you know, kind of, I guess, maybe. Is it really like this old pagan holiday that used to be this, you know, real ritualistic thing, and then all of a sudden Christians kind of took it over and they made it from a pagan holiday to a Christian holiday, and the tree used to be a symbol of everlasting gods, and now it's a sign of God's everlasting love. And I guess so. But you think about, what is Christmas? What is Christmas? Because when you read your Bible, when you look at God's word, you don't actually even find anything about Christmas in the Bible. And as a matter of fact, the term Christmas as we know it, didn't even show up until the Bible had already been written and agreed upon to be called the Bible. Christmas was long after that, 500-600 years, several hundred years after the Bible and in the events of Jesus' life. Now all of a sudden we have this thing we call Christmas. And so the question I ask, the challenge that I ask to you and to me, is what is Christmas? if it's not really the day that Jesus was born, if it might have been some pagan holiday that was translated into a Christian holiday, what is the purpose of Christmas? I mean, if it was so important for us to celebrate this, why is it that only Matthew and Luke in four chapters in the Bible talk about this season? If it was that big of a deal, why doesn't God's own word say more about that? And today what I want to do is I want to tonight define what I believe God's desire when we see what Christmas is. I want to define what Christmas is. What is Christmas? Well, let's break it down. It's called etymology. Let's break down the word of Christmas. Christmas literally means Christ Mass. Okay, I get it a little bit now. Christ, we don't have to explain that, right? We all understand what Christ means, right? Jesus Christ, right? So we understand the first part of that word. The second part of the word, Mass. I know what Mass is. My neighbor's Catholic, and they go to Mass. So Christmas must be the Mass of Jesus. You can say it like this. What is Mass? Mass is a service, right? So it's the service of Jesus. Is it a special service on a special day? No. What is Mass? Let's think about that for a moment. What is Mass? Mass was a name given to the action or the title of the Eucharist. You're like, Pastor Lee, you are totally losing me right now. Are you going to quiz me on this? Yes, I am. St. Peter, I believe, at the gates of heaven is going to ask you, what did Pastor Luke say the Eucharist was? I'm just kidding. You don't need to know this. Mass is the name given to the thing called the Eucharist. What is the Eucharist? The Eucharist is the Latin word or the Latin or Greek word of saying or describing the central act of Christian worship. It's not a service. It's not a gathering. It's not a calling out. The Eucharist is the central act of Christian worship. And what is the central act of Christian worship? Well, to the early church, it was the act of communion. What is communion? Break it down even further. What is communion? Well, we know that communion is that time when we have church service, right? And they give us that little thing with grape juice and that like styrofoam bread wafer that's gluten, sugar, all ingredient free. We don't even know what it's made out of, right? No. Communion was the act of giving thanks to God. See, Jesus on that Last Supper, Paul recounts it in 1 Corinthians 11 chapter, says Jesus, he gave thanks and he broke the bread and he passed it around. And then he gave thanks likewise. And to the cup of wine, and he said, this wine represents my blood that is spilled for you or poured out for you. So the Eucharist, Mass, communion, is the central act of Christian worship, which is the act of giving thanks to God for Jesus Christ. So then I ask this question, what is Christmas? If you add the words Eucharist or Mass, giving thanks, to the word Christ, Christmas as defined by its own self is this. It is the action or the act of giving thanks to God for Jesus Christ. That's what Christmas is. It's not about a birthday because we don't know the day that Jesus was born. It's not a global birthday party, although that might be what we think it is today. Christmas is the act of giving thanks to God for Jesus Christ. It's the central act of Christian worship for you and for me. And so when we think about this holiday season, and when we think about all the different things that we do, when we think about the lights and the presents and the food and the parties and the Hallmark movies and the carols and the old Rat Pack songs and Coast 103.5, and we think about all the different things that Christmas brings to you and I ask, are we celebrating Christmas? Are we celebrating Christmas? Because if it's not even something that we can find in the Bible by what we see it today, happy birthday, Jesus, then we're missing something. But if you look at what Christmas is, the act of giving thanks to God for Jesus Christ, what's beautiful about that is something that you can find in God's Word, in what we would call the Christmas story. I had to go to Luke, the second chapter. And there the angels came to these shepherds and they said, I bring you good tidings of glad joy. The story progresses in Luke, the second chapter, that the shepherds say, let's go check out what the angels are talking about, this baby that they're talking about in Bethlehem. So they go to Bethlehem and they find Jesus there in the manger with Mary and Joseph, and they see Jesus. And now in Luke, the second chapter, look what we see in verse number 20. Luke, the second chapter, verse number 20 says, and then the shepherds returned after they saw Jesus. They returned glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen as it was told them. What are the shepherds doing? The shepherds are exemplifying, acting in the very first tradition of Christmas, of giving thanks to God for Jesus Christ. The very first Christmas was, in fact, on Jesus' birthday. Whatever day that might be on the calendar, we do not know. We have chosen to celebrate it in the season of December, on the winter solstice, December 25th, around that season. So now we say Christmas is the very act of celebrating or thanking God for Jesus Christ. And that's what the shepherds did. And now you can say we have seen and we can see. From the very beginning all the way through the book of Revelation, we can see Christmas in the Bible. Why? Because throughout the narrative of the New Testament, there are people that have thanked God for Jesus Christ in their lives. And that is what Christmas is all about. That's what Christmas is all about. Are you guys with me today? So then you think about it like this, and I ask myself this question. If somebody was to come and observe my life, to come and observe your life, who had no clue, no concept, no idea of what we celebrate Christmas for, would they know what Christmas really is? By our actions, by our attitudes, by the words that we say, by the things that we do, by the services that we attend, by the songs that we sing, would they know the real meaning of Christmas, the act of giving thanks to God for Jesus Christ? Or would they see what we've created in culture today? Over-economized system, a commercialized way of thinking, an idea wrapped around spirit and Yuletide and tradition and red and white and reindeer and rosy cheeks and chestnuts roasting on an open fire and snow falling. Would they see that? Because you see, when I ask that question, all of the things that we subject ourselves to, is that what God wants us for? I'm not knocking Christmas in the holiday season. I want you to understand that. I'm not knocking Christmas lights. I'm not knocking Christmas trees. As a matter of fact, I got a lot of Christmas lights. I have 2 Christmas trees in my house. Both of them. One of them is a children's tree. One of them is kind of like we put it together and it looks more respectable, an adult tree. I love the Christmas season. But what I'm asking is, are we celebrating Christmas for what it really is? The act of giving thanks to God for Jesus Christ. You know, I think about it like this, and what I found over this year, I was just kind of just asking God today, as He impressed upon my heart, Lord, what do you want me to talk about? What do I have 35 minutes to the length of a sitcom? What do I have to talk about that you want people to know and take away? And in the conversations that I've had over the course of this holiday season, God brought something to my attention. And that's, you know, talking to my kids about Christmas, talking to friends about Christmas, talking to family members about celebrating on Christmas Day or how we're gonna go about celebrating Christmas. One thing I found that there was a commonality in all of these conversations. The commonality was that all of these conversations evolved eventually into the Christmas list. The Christmas list. You know what a Christmas list is? The Christmas list is the list of all the things you don't have, but that you want for Christmas. Asking my kids, well, what do you want for Christmas? Family members, what do you want for Christmas? People asking me, what do you want for Christmas? And we, in our minds, we, in our hearts, we, in our lives, we physically develop this thing we call a Christmas list. Right? What do you want? Well, I've taken the quick moment of writing some things down that I don't have that I would really like to have because Christmas is all about giving. And I'm not knocking that because Jesus himself, Paul quotes Jesus in Acts the 20th chapter, says Jesus said that it's better to give than to receive. So who am I to rob somebody of the blessing of giving to me in this wonderful holiday season? So I have just simply done what everybody else expected to do, and that's to create a Christmas list. So we have a Christmas list of the different things that we don't have that we want. And you think about it like this, we're trained to do that. We're trained to create Christmas lists. Why? Because I think back to my life and my own life. My earliest memory of a Christmas list. Second grade, by the time I learned how to develop words into sentences. We took time in my second grade class to write letters to Santa Claus. To ask Santa Claus the things that we did not have that we wanted for Christmas. Santa, I really want this new toy for Christmas. And then in that second grade class, we put them in an envelope and we sealed them and we addressed them to the North Pole and we sent them away. And then 2 weeks or 3 weeks later, we actually got a letter back from Santa Claus saying, I'm working really hard. I've got my elves in the North Pole working really hard to fill your Christmas list. And I didn't realize or recognize at the time, but it was highly suspicious that Santa Claus's handwriting and his grammar was the sixth grade level. And I didn't understand this conspiracy until I myself found myself in the sixth grade. And then I understood. But by that time, I'd already had years of developing a Christmas list of the things I don't have, but that I want for Christmas. And you know, you might say, well, you know, Pastor Luke, I don't have a Christmas list. My wife and I, we really don't have Christmas lists for each other. When Stacy says, what do you get me? I don't know what to get you. And I say, I don't know. I don't want anything. And she knows, that's a trap. I'm not jumping into that. If I don't get you anything, you're going to get me something. And I'm not going to be the one that. And so even though you say, I don't have a Christmas list, when you think about what a Christmas list is, it's a wish list. It's a list of things that we don't have that we wish we would have. And so maybe you don't have a list or an Amazon shopping cart or something like that of all the different gadgets and big screen TVs and game consoles or movies or phones or whatever the latest this or that is. You may not have that list. We all have a Christmas list at some point in some place in our life. Because there are things in our lives that we do not have that we want in our hearts. Maybe that Christmas list to you is I just want somebody to love this Christmas. Maybe that Christmas list to you is I just want fulfillment this Christmas. Maybe that Christmas list to you is I just want that home for Christmas. I just want that car for Christmas. I just want that promotion for Christmas. Maybe that Christmas list to you is I just want that, whatever it might be, for Christmas. And what a Christmas list is, it's a list full of things that we do not have that we want for Christmas. Very simple concept. But then when you think about what Christmas is, Christmas is the act of giving gratitude, thanksgiving to God for Jesus. And then we look at what we do in our hearts and in our lives and our families, and we create lists of things that we do not have that we want. And the problem arises to me that when we look at the things and when our eyes are focused on the things that we do not have, that does not incite or instill a sense of gratitude in my heart. It does not instill a sense of great thanksgiving to God for Jesus. It instills a sense of lack, a sense of, well, there are things that I don't have. There are things that I'm missing. There are things that I'd really like to have. I'd really like to see come to pass in my life, but yet I don't have them. And then we become acutely aware of the things that we don't have. And therefore, are we really living out what God desired for us in this Christmas season? And so simply put, my challenge to you tonight, very simple, is to make Christmas about what it's supposed to be. The act of thanksgiving to God for Jesus Christ. I'm not telling you don't put a tree up. I've got two in my house. I'm not telling you don't participate in the Christmas parties. You ought to go. I'm not telling you don't get an ugly Christmas sweater. They're kind of fun. I'm not telling you don't give somebody a fruitcake even though you know they don't like fruitcake. I'm not telling you don't participate in what we call Christmas today. But what I am challenging us as a church, as followers of Jesus, is to make Christmas what it's really about, an act of thanksgiving to God for Jesus. And here's what I want to do. I want to take that challenge one step further, and I kind of want to turn everything we've talked about on its head. Can I do that for you? Can I do that right now? Would you be all right? Are you tracking with me? Or are you like, I don't even know what you're talking about? Either way, I'm going to do it right now. I'm going to ask you this. Would you make a Christmas list this holiday season? Well, but Pastor Luke, the Christmas list is everything I don't have that I want, and that doesn't bring thanksgiving in my heart. Let me add a new word then. Would you make a new Christmas list this holiday season? Would you do it? Would you be willing to make a new Christmas list this holiday season? You say, I'm not going to say yes until I know what that list is. Not a list of things you don't have. Would you be willing this week to start a list of the things that you do have to be thankful to God for through Jesus Christ? Would you be willing to create a Christmas list this season of all of the things you have in life to be thankful to God through Jesus Christ today? Because I believe that is the list, and the spirit of the Christmas season is the act of giving thanks to God for His Son, Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, Paul the Apostle in the book of Colossians writes in his third chapter. Paul didn't write in chapters, but in the third chapter of Colossians, in the 15th verse, Paul begins to write to the church of Colossae, and he says, let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which you were called in one body. And he says, be thankful. The Christmas spirit. Verse number 16, and he goes on, and he says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and in spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. That kind of sounds like Christmas carols. I think this is a Christmas message. In verse number 17, he says, and whatever you do in word or in deed, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. You see, going back to what that crazy Latin word Eucharist was, the central act of Christian worship, the central act of worship in the Old and the New Testament from Genesis to Revelation was thanksgiving to God. That's why God instituted feasts. That's why God instituted special days. That's why God instituted offerings. Why? So that the people's eyes would not fixate upon what they do not have, but rather that their eyes would turn to the things that they do have through their God, their Redeemer, and that they would give gratitude and give thanks to Him, and they would live a grateful life to what God has done for them. Now, Paul the Apostle is saying to the Gentile church who had no idea of that, he's saying, listen, in everything that you do, your life is supposed to be a life of gratitude to God. The Christmas spirit is not something you celebrate from the day after Cyber Monday Monday to the day after New Year's Day. Christmas spirit is something that we do all year long, all our lives. Why? Because it is the act of giving thanks to God for Jesus Christ. Dinners and the parties and the gifts and the presents and the $575 the average American will spend on gifts, $800 billion this month. Would you create a new Christmas list? A list of the things you are grateful to God for through Jesus Christ. Would you do it? Can I get an amen if you do it? Is there anybody in this place willing to create a new Christmas list? Let me see where you're at. Listen, I don't want to leave you with a challenge, and get your phones. If you got a phone, get your phone out. Come on, I even brought my phone. Let's do it. Let's start it. Would you get your phones out? Anybody? If you got your phone, hold it up like a rock concert, like a candle. Let me see all the lights. If you don't have a phone, or you know what, maybe you're taking notes and you got a notepad, you can use your notepad. Let's create a Christmas list right now. Turn to a new page in your notepad and let's create a Christmas list together. Let me start you off. So grab your phone, grab your notepad, whatever it is, and let's go to the note-taking app that you use on your phone, whether that's Notes, whether on Android. I don't know what that is because I have an Apple phone because it's better, whatever it might be. You go to the note-taking device, the Evernote, whatever it might be, and you open up a new note. Would you do that? Tell me when you're there. Shout amen, shout hallelujah, shout I got it. Just hold your phone up. Okay, now title your note, My Christmas List. Start typing. Look at that, these guys. The Christmas List. And I'm going to give you, I'm going to prime the pump for you today, okay? So that you can go home tonight, you can go tomorrow, you can go on Tuesday, you can go on Wednesday, you can go next week, you can go next month, you can go next year, and you can start to develop your Christmas list. Let's start. I'm going to give you three things today. Number one, of things that you are thankful to God through Jesus Christ. Number one, I am thankful for Jesus coming to die for my sins. That's something worth being thankful to God for, isn't it? I'm thankful that God sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish, but would have everlasting life. Guys, got that number one? Priming the pump, type. Come on, get your little fingers typing faster. Number two, I am thankful for God's unending love for me. I love what Paul says in Romans, the fifth chapter, that God demonstrated his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Now, I see some of y'all taking pictures. Don't be cheating. That is not a list. That is a picture. Open up your note app and write it. Why? Because I want you to continue this list after tonight. And number three, I'm priming your pump, okay? I am thankful for God's grace through Jesus Christ. See, Christmas is the very act of giving thanksgiving to God for Jesus Christ. It's exactly what the shepherds did after they saw Jesus in the manger. They left and they glorified and they praised God for what they had seen. That is what Christmas is the act of giving thanks to God for Jesus. I've given you three things. You know what you might say in your life, Pastor? I don't have much to be thankful for. Why? Because I'm alone this Christmas. I've got nothing. I've got no money. I've got no possessions. I've got nowhere to go. I've got nothing to do. I've got nothing going on this Christmas. You've got three things to start thinking about as to how you can celebrate and live in the Christmas spirit today, because God sent his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die for you and for me and for our sins. He loved us unending even when we did not love him. God loved us. And his grace covers us when we didn't deserve it, when we didn't earn it, when we couldn't do anything about it. His grace came through Jesus Christ. That is the spirit of Christmas. You say, I don't have very much else to celebrate for that. I believe that if you start asking God through the course of this week, on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday, when you're at your job or whatever it might be, when you're stuck in traffic, to start thinking about what can I add to my Christmas list, I believe God will start to give you some things in your heart. I'll just give you some things. You can't copy mine. These are mine. I'll read you some things as I was pondering. I'm thankful for God's master plan because my plan stinks. I'm thankful that God's word is real, it's true, and it's applicable in my own life. I'm thankful for my wife because I am blessed. I'm thankful for my kids because they are amazing. I'm thankful for my work because it's not a job, it's a calling. I'm thankful for my friends because I may not have very many of them, but the ones that I do have, they're amazing. I'm thankful for my family. They sometimes challenge me, but I won't grow unless I'm challenged, and they always have my back. I'm thankful for my health. My body might ache, but I can walk. I can run. I can do almost anything. I'm thankful for my church. These are things I wrote because there's some amazing people here. I'm thankful for my home because it's a dream house. I'm thankful for the places that I've traveled and the people that I've met along the way. I'm thankful for my education because I thought I'd never use it, but I do. I'm thankful for the men and the women that God has used to teach, to equip, and to inspire me. I'm thankful that I can breathe, that my heart beats, that my eyes, my ears, and my tongue work. I'm thankful for the wonderful memories I've had with the grandparents that were here and that while they were alive and cognitive. I'm thankful for cheese. That's right, cheese. I am thankful that I am an American citizen who was born into a blessed family. I am thankful that I have seen God's glory in his church and in the wilderness. I am thankful that I don't have to go to bed hungry tonight or that I am not in financial need. I am thankful for the many blessings, material and spiritual and emotional, that I have received from God. You see, that is the Christmas list I believe God wants his people to write. The act of giving thanks to God for his son, Jesus. And you know what happens? Paul tells his young protege, Timothy, in the sixth chapter. He says, Timothy, all the different things of the world, all the idle babblings, all the gossips, all the different things that come to distract us. Paul tells his young protege in Timothy, 1 Timothy, the sixth chapter, verse number 6. He says, Timothy, godliness with contentment is great gain. Because you see, our culture has taught us to chase and to be acutely aware of the things that we do not have, that we might pursue them with our lives. But the gospel teaches us a different message. The gospel teaches us to focus on the things that we do have, that we might live content lives. And if we don't receive anything else, we have Jesus. And God says, if you got nothing else, that is enough to survive on earth, because you got something ahead of you in the future. And then when you think about what the true Christmas spirit is, and the Christmas list that you start reciting to yourself every morning as you wake up, the reasons that you have to be thankful to God for His Son, Jesus Christ, the parties, the gifts, the lights, the inflatable characters in your front yard, the fruit cakes that you receive, the gift cards to the places you'll never shop, get to, whatever it might be, you know what happens? They become just plain fun. Why? Because it's not about that anymore. It's not about that. That's not what Christmas is. Christmas isn't lights and gifts and songs and Yuletide and turkey and family dinners. Christmas isn't ugly sweaters and carols and candy canes. Christmas is the act of giving thanks to God for what Jesus has done. And when I do that, I no longer focus on the things that I do not have and that I want, but rather now I focus on the things that I do have. And I am grateful to God for what I do have. And therefore, everything else around me, hey, it's all peripheral. Why? Because now I am living in the Christmas spirit. So remember this. What is Christmas? A global birthday party? A religious tradition? Christmas is simply this. It's Christ's Mass. It's the act of giving thanks to God for Jesus Christ. That's what it is. And when we make Christmas about Christmas, and when we make Christmas lists in our lives, and we recite them and we don't forget them until next year, our whole prospect in life, outlook of what the Christmas season really is, will completely change all around us, because the main thing will be the main thing. Giving thanks to God because there was a baby born in a manger that came to die for my sins so that I could be reconnected to God. We got lots to be thankful for today. Did you guys get something out of that tonight? Amen. Amen. Hey, listen. Before we leave tonight, just quickly, it's an intimate night. A few visitors. Most of us are here for repeat services and part of the church. But I just want to take a quick moment to examine our hearts, to examine our lives. And just as we cried out tonight, Holy Spirit, burn within my heart. Cried out for the presence of God in our lives. And I said this, told this story about the disciples on the road to Emmaus. I truly believe with all of my heart, that's the salvation story of God. You see, salvation, connection with God, relationship with God, it's not about a religious tradition. It's not about fulfilling some ceremonial ritual. It's not about a profession that we make. It's not about a mindset that we have. There's something that happens to us when we wholly surrender our hearts and when we wholly surrender our lives to Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, Jesus talks to a religious man about this very subject in the book of John in his third chapter. And Jesus says to this man, Nicodemus, he says, in order to inherit eternal life, he says, you must be born again. Born again from Hollywood and culture's perspective means to that kind of weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. But listen, in Jesus' eyes, born again always meant the same thing. And Jesus says, listen, it's not about what you do on the outside that makes you okay with me. It's not about your religious affiliation. It's not about your mental ascent. It's not about your carnal knowledge. It's not about your good works or your good deeds or your involvement in a volunteer organization. Jesus says these words. He says, unless on the inside you're born again, you'll not inherit the kingdom of God. And inheritance is for those who are on the inside. And born again from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word has always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. From Genesis to Revelation, it means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. See, God's not after your outward actions. He's not after how good you look and how well you can speak Christianese. What is Christianese? Christianese is that Christian language that Christians often speak that nobody else knows what they're talking about, church talk. God's not after how well you're affluent in church talk. He's not interested in the cross that you wear around your neck or the religious jewelry that you have or on your wall or your pictures or of the crucifix. He's not interested in those things. You see, God is interested in your heart and in your soul. Because deeply rooted in each and every one of us as humans is this nature of sin, this disconnection to God. You see, Paul writes in Romans, he says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Nobody had to teach us how to lie. Nobody had to teach us how to cheat. Nobody had to teach us how to expand on the truth or to do any of those things. We kind of figured that out on our own. And you see, that's that sin nature on the inside of us. But God tells us in his Old Testament that God in his righteousness cannot even so much look upon sin. And so because of that nature that we've been born into because of the decisions of humans that have gone before us, you see, now we're born into this position of disability. No matter what we do, no matter how hard we try, no matter how good we look, we're never going to be good enough for God. And Jesus says, the only way you can get that to be right with me, to be good enough for me, is to be born again. What is born again? He's talking about your soul. He's talking about your heart. And he says, if you'd surrender that, like we sang, we had that moment today, that intimate moment. He says, if you'd surrender that to me, if you'd surrender your life to me, not just your Sunday attendance, not just your good works, not just your thoughts, he said, but if you'd surrender your life to me, he says, I'd come and I'd fill it with my presence and I'd fill it with my life. See, in God's word in the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church people like you and I. And he says, listen, I know what you're doing. I see your works. He says, I'm coming back and I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, you're not really up, you're not really down, you're not really in, you're not really out, you're not really one thing, you're not really the other, you're not wholehearted for me, you're not wholehearted against me, kind of occasional church attendance token prayer. He says, but find that that's you. He says, I will vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus. And what he's saying is that you're going to get rejected from my kingdom. But you see, that's not God's plan. That's not God's purpose. That's not what he sent Jesus Christ to do, is to reject anyone. Paul says that it's God's will that all be saved. And today I want to give you the invitation of receiving the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus said these words in John the 10th chapter. He says that he has come that you and I might receive life and that we might receive it abundantly here on earth as well as in eternity with him in heaven. And the only way that we get that is by receiving the gift of eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. And today I want to give you the opportunity in just a moment to receive that gift. And in that same scripture that Jesus talks to in the book of Revelation to the church, Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. He says, if you just open up that door, I'd come in. We'd have communion. What is communion? It's the act of relationship, of giving thanks to God, is what we talked about today. We'd have relationship together. See, God's desire is for you to have an intimate relationship with him through his son, Jesus Christ. It's an all or nothing relationship with God. Today, I want to give you the opportunity to receive that invitation. Maybe the Holy Spirit's been speaking to you tonight about your life, about your position. And I believe that the Bible tells us that none of us can come to God except through the leading of the Holy Spirit. And I believe tonight that there are those of you that the Holy Spirit is speaking to you tonight. I want to give you that opportunity right now to receive that gift of eternal salvation. Here's what we're going to do in just a moment. We're going to pray a prayer of salvation. You're going to invite Jesus to come and to be the leader, the Lord and Savior of your life. But before we do that, I want to ask, would you make that decision to pray that prayer with me tonight? So here's what we're going to do in just a moment. I'm going to ask everybody just to bow their heads and close their eyes and just to take a moment with God. And when we do that, I just want you to think about your life. Think about where you stand with God. If you were to leave tonight, would you go to heaven? If you were to die, if you were to get into a car accident and something were to happen to you, God forbid, would you be okay with God? How you answer that has a lot to say about where your position with God is. Today, I want to give you that opportunity to receive the invitation of Jesus Christ into your heart and your life. If you've never given him your heart, never given your life, in just a moment, if that's you, I'm going to count to three. Like this, I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. I'll smack my hands together. If that's you, I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. And what you're doing is you're saying, you know what, today, I want to pray that prayer. I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge you. Put it right back down. Why is that important? Because Jesus said that if you'd confess him before men, he'd confess you before his Father. Today, what you're doing is you're saying, you know what, that prayer that you're going to pray, I want to pray with you today. I'm making a decision to follow Jesus. I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge you, and put it right back down. If you're not sure tonight, don't walk out of here without making sure. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, you've been playing the church game, Sunday game, whatever it might be, listen, don't walk out of this place today without giving your heart, without giving your life to Jesus Christ. Why? Because that's a gamble on your eternal life that you just can't afford to make. You don't know what tomorrow holds. And I'm not trying to paint a picture of fear, but I am trying to paint a picture of reality. That God sent Jesus to die on a cross for you and I so that we could be reconnected to him. And in return, he wants all of our heart. He wants all of our life. He wants a divine relationship with you on the inside of your life. A deep and intimate relationship with God. Can you imagine that? The creator of the universe wants to know you and you to know him intimately. And today he's offering you an invitation. Will you receive that invitation? If you would, all across the auditorium, would you just take a moment, bow your heads, close your eyes? We're not doing that out of shame. We're not doing that because we're embarrassed. I'm asking you to do that because I want you to tune out everything else right now. Tune out what you're going to eat for dinner, what you're going to do this week. Start tune out what your list is about right now. I want you to focus on God. Where do you stand in your relationship with God? And as you focus in on that position of what we've been speaking about tonight, what we've been speaking about today is you right now. I want to give you the opportunity with heads bowed and eyes closed to receive and to respond to the invitation of Jesus Christ. I'm going to count to three all across this auditorium. If that's you in this place, when I do, you pop your hand up. I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge it, and right after that, what we're going to do is we'll all stand together, and I'll ask you to come up here, and I want to shake your hand, and we'll pray together. What you're doing by raising your hand is you're saying, I want to give my heart to Jesus. That's me today. I want to receive that invitation. I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, and put it right back down, and we'll pray that prayer of salvation together. All across this auditorium, if that's you, from the front row to the back row, side to side, family rooms, on closed circuit television, or even at home on the live stream, wherever you're at, this is your moment, this is your time. Today is the day of your salvation. Will you respond to the invitation of the Holy Spirit in your life? If that's you, I'm going to count to three. And when I do, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and put your hand right back down. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. If that's you, say, I want to give my heart. I see you right there. If that's you, I see you over there. I see that hand. Say, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Anybody in this place? Anybody else? I've seen about two hands. All right. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. A couple of people. That's cool. I feel like there's some more of you in this place. And here's what we're going to do. We're running out of time. We're out of time. So let's do this. Let's pray together. Would you join me? And if you want to give your heart, would you want to give your life to Jesus Christ? Here's what we're going to do. We're all going to stand. And I want to just ask if you would. Would you join me and let's pray together? And I want to just shake your hand for a moment. I'd ask if you just grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend, if you need a friend, a family member, if you came with somebody or you want to bring somebody, grab a hold of them. And would you come and meet me up here at this aisle so that we can pray a prayer of salvation together? If that's you in this place, if you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, would you come and meet me right here? Come on, let's change destinies for Jesus today. If that's you in this place, come and meet me right here. Come on, let's pray together right here, right now. In the house today. Encourage our brothers and sisters. Come on, my sister. Hey, congratulations. Hang out right here. I'm going to pray with you, okay? Just hang out right here. I'm going to pray with you. If that's you in this place, I'm going to just ask Elijah to sing one more time because I just feel in my heart there's somebody in this place that you need to give your life to Jesus. He's calling you home. Would you come home today? Would you just pray with me today? That prayer of salvation. Anybody else in this place, you come. This is your moment. This is your time. Well, hey, sister, you did it. Congratulations. You know, I'll tell you a story real quick. I told a lot of stories, but Jesus tells this really cool story about a shepherd, and it's a story, okay? It's not real, but he says that there's a shepherd who has 100 sheep, and he says that shepherd who has 100 sheep loses one of them. And he says, what does he do? He leaves the 99 good ones to go into the woods and find that lost one. And you know what's cool about that? Is he says he brings that lost one, he puts it over his shoulder, and he comes back and he tells everybody, look, what was once lost is now found. And he says, all of heaven rejoices over that one lost that comes back. You might be up here all by yourself, but Jesus tells us that all of heaven rejoices just for you. And maybe nobody else has told you good job today, but let me tell you, good job. You're doing a good job. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray a prayer together, right? God doesn't listen to the words of your mouth like some abracadabra magical prayer. He listens to the prayer of your heart. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer, and I'm going to ask everybody to follow. So we're all going to pray together, all right? But you just repeat these words after me. But you use your mouth, but you believe it with your heart. All right, let's go before the Lord. Let's pray together. Would y'all join with me? Let's pray together. Let's all bow our heads, close our eyes. You repeat these words after me today. Father, I come before you today. And I need you. I need Jesus. Today I make the decision to give my life, to give my heart to Jesus Christ. I ask that you forgive me of my past. Cleanse me of my sin. And I dedicate my future to you. Fill me with your wonderful spirit. From this day forward, I'm going to follow Jesus with all of my life and with all of my heart. I'm a Christian, headed for heaven with a new future in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Here's what I want to do really quickly. See this guy right over here? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel just wants to take you right over there. Nothing weird goes on. He's going to give you some free information. He's going to pray with you if you need some prayer. And he's going to invite you to come back and hang out with somebody here at the church to teach you some things about the Word of God and buy you a cup of coffee or something like that. Okay? So if you just go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel. Amen.